So thank you so much, Philip Martin, for being on the Tin Roof Project here at Tales from the South.
It is my absolute delight.
So in Chicago, 23 years ago, you get into the violent altercation with the mugger. So had you ever been in a fight before this?
I grew up as a physically competent person. I played games as a kid, and I am not afraid of a little, but no, I believe in kindness, and I'm not a fighter. And I understand why someone might be very horrified to see me do what I did that night. And it was a stupid thing, and I'm not especially proud of it, but it makes a good story, so.
So you had never been in a fight before or since?
Well, I wouldn't say I'd never been in a fight, but I've never, and no, not like that, no. Not anything serious, ever, and never again, no.
Lesson learned. Okay, so when you moved to Arizona, you said that you thought you'd never come back to the South.
Well, you know, I was on the cusp of my 30s then, and at that point in my life, I was, I think, pretty much careerist. I mean, I really could see a line where I was going to Phoenix, going to Los Angeles, going to New York. I was working for a pretty big place in Phoenix. I had an office. I had a secretary I could call and get me a plane ticket. I could do this. I could do that. And it's one of those things that I think that I just didn't countenance it. I didn't really think there was much of a future here for me, which shows you how wrong I am.
And so what was it like when you came back to the South after being in those places? What was that like for you? I mean, I know this was home to you in a lot of ways, but...
Well, you know, I grew up. I lived all around the country. I lived in California. I lived in North Carolina. I identify as a Southerner, and it's sort of like being Jewish. It's sort of like being, you know, it's an identity you can carry with you and pull out when you want to. I mean, my book, The Artificial Southerner, is really about the mask that we all put on. I'm never more Southern than when I'm in New York City, and I'm never seriously, you know, and I don't. The South is a place that's, we were the part of the country that was occupied. We were a conquered country. We were the cradle of America's original sin, you know, slavery. I mean, we have a lot of stuff to work through. And, you know, I'm happy to work through it. I mean, it's very interesting to be a writer here and to be from here. I think sometimes we make a little bit too much of our accidents of nativity. I mean, I'd be perfectly happy, I think, you know, living in Washington or New Zealand. You know, I mean, I'm Paris, France. But I identify as a Southerner because that's the part of me that... comes out when I'm doing this stuff, you know. Mainly, it's when I'm working and when I'm working with this or with a keyboard, you know. That's sort of what I am.
And so, in your story, you mentioned that you passed the audition with the quote "rangy black beast, all sideways slipping legs and hot drool," which
Cold
is
Dog.
A great image.
Anybody remember Cold Dog? He used to write some stuff for the newspaper. Yeah. Cold Dog died about 2006, but he ain't never gone, you know, he's still here. And, you know, I sort of measure out my life now in dogs, you know. It's like we just got to kind of send in the replacements. You know, we went through a span recently, well, I say recently, starting with Coley in 2006, we lost three that were about 15 years old, boom, boom, boom. And, you know, we just keep going with new ones, rescue dogs and, you know, terriers. Terriers are great. I used to be a big dog chauvinist, but you know, big dogs are wonderful. Little dogs are great too. They're very smart. They're very too smart.
And so I've heard through the grapevine that you have a song about some of your dogs.
Yeah,
is that right? You all want to hear him sing it?
Yeah.
Okay. About this singing stuff. I'm a songwriter, and I do this mainly because I don't have the sense not to. But I'm you know, so. And this is a song that I wrote about one of our dogs when she was getting old, but I'll just sing it. You have to Chirpa's started getting slow. There's a problem with her hips. She can't find perches on the floor. She struggles and she slips. And though you've been through it all before, and there's a part of it you hate, when it's time for walking, the old dog's at the gate. Sherpa shuffles down the hall to a blanket on the floor. She needs it laid out just right, she don't jump up anymore. Dublin has an old tweed chair to rest her feathered head. Paris likes to sleep with us, three heartbeats in the bed. Tongues that know no language, they don't philosophize. Don't betray your secrets, they don't tell you any lies. Audie's eyes are Bible black and Paris's are gold. Coley's eyes got cloudy before he got very old. Sometimes I wake up at night and the grain is dim before dawn. I watch my girl sleeping and I know nothing's wrong. My tongues know no language, I don't philosophize. I don't betray your secrets, they don't tell you any lies. You can buy their self-help books and expensive flattery. You can marinate down your whole world and call it therapy. You can shutter up your soul, fetishize your victimhood. Eating out your bitter heart, pretending that it's good. Tongues know no language, don't philosophize. Don't betray your secrets, they don't tell you any lies. Sometimes I wake up at night in the gloom and dim before dawn. Watch my girl sleeping and I know. It's always embarrassing to do this when there are real musicians in the house, and I apologize.
All right, well, we have a few minutes here at the end for audience questions. So if you have a question for Philip, you can ask him about his writing, his music, the newspaper, his life, whatever you'd like to ask him about, and perhaps he'll answer it.
Yeah,
and,
it's just like Reddit up here, yeah.
So if you have a question, if you would, this mic reaches pretty far. I'll bring the mic over to you. Just raise your hand, and we'll see if we can get it back to you.
Your favorite movie?
Okay, my favorite movie, Hiroshima Mon Amour. That's off the top of my head. The second is The Searchers, you know, John Ford. And I could probably, ask me tomorrow, I'd probably change, you know. Waking Life, Richard Linklater. I like it, too. So, I mean, and there's probably 20 that kind of circle through there, you know, so that was easy.
Why Frank Lloyd Wright?
I'm glad you asked that. Well, I am interested. There's a couple things. I've always been interested in architecture, and I admire Wright as an artist. And one of the things that happened when I went to Phoenix, actually, was I got a chance to do a lot of research and investigate and got a lot of Mr. Wright's acolytes, as they call themselves, really mad at me for writing about his you know, some of the stuff. And I was really fascinated by the cult that surrounds the guy and his longevity. I mean, and he's, and these stories. I mean, the Mamum Boatwright Cheney story is just fascinating. I really did intend to at some point write a play about that or write something about that, but I just, you know, I'm just making it up. I mean, it's kind of hard for me to go. It turns out that Edwin Cheney you know, there's evidence that maybe he wasn't quite the tragic figure that I sort of portray him. I mean, I found this out later, but I mean, he may have started up with a woman himself right after Mama started up, so I don't know. And it was, and they were all friends, and they were in the 19th century women's club together, and there's, it was really kind of complicated, more complicated than I make it, but then, you know, what's a writer for, if not to oversimplify? Yes?
Do you think films are getting better, or no. Do you think they're getting worse?
I think that there is an opportunity right now for people to make movies, and they're going to, and we're going to have a lot of really great movies, but 90% of what we're going to have is drunk, like we've always said. I think that if you're talking about Hollywood, commercial movies are getting worse because people in Hollywood figured out how to sell movies to people who don't really care about movies, you know? And so you've got people who just go for the explosions and just go for the special effects and just go for this, and that's fine. I mean, they just go for the sensation, but we've lost, I mean, the movies in the 70s, the early 70s movies that, you know, you've lost those. Those are, they went to independent cinema, and now independent cinema really, you know, is hurting, and, you know. It, but if you want to see a character-driven thing, you know, you'll be able to see it on the internet. You'll be able to see it in your iPad. You'll be able to see it on Netflix. But, you know, as far as going to the movies and going to the Cinemark now, or, you know, you're going to get the same thing again and again, you know, because that's what people go to. Yeah. It's like McDonald's. You know, people go to McDonald's more than they come here.
Unfortunately, that is true.
Billions and billions, you know?
All right, so how about our story and storyteller tonight?
Good, I'm free. Look at a drink.